Hey, Dr. C with you. Let's talk about how to quickly reduce iodine levels. So there's a really tight relationship between iodine intake and thyroid disease. There have been historical times in which iodine deficiency was a common problem. That's no longer the case. Now we've had 7 cases of iodine deficiency since 1980, so it's extremely rare. But iodine excess is common. It's probably the largest single controllable cause of adult thyroid disease in the modern world. Many people are aware that their disease came on after ingesting high doses of iodine. I've heard really common stories where someone will say that they were using a kelp supplement or an iodorol supplement, and they started getting a racing heart, or they started getting a swelling and a pain in their thyroid. And they know that's when the disease came on. That's when the abnormalities show up. And they want it to go away. And they want to see if there's some way they can get that out more quickly. So the issue is that iodine can build up in the thyroid, but it can only come out very, very slowly. So in this video, we'll talk about how this all works, what this means, and things you might be able to do to help it get out more quickly, and how you can know how far along you are. So the process is that the thyroid has a pump that pulls in iodine and then attaches that onto a protein called thyroglobulin. The pump itself pulls in more if there's less present, pulls in less when there's more present, and tries to keep things working right. And for many people over a range of iodine intake, it's all fine. But some people can't tolerate the excess. And if someone like that gets too much iodine for too long, the pump doesn't work as well. And one of two things can happen. It can simply fail to modulate and too much iodine can get in, or it can just shut down dramatically to try to protect the thyroid. And that can cause too little to get in. So paradoxically, too much iodine can cause the same problems as too little. But for those to where, if this goes on too long, oftentimes it does start to absorb it again, and too much may accumulate within the gland. So iodine leaves the thyroid primarily when it's made into thyroid hormones. For someone whose thyroid is underactive and they're on thyroid medication, there's not much, if any, thyroid hormones coming out of the thyroid. And consequently, there's not a lot of iodine that leaves the thyroid. There is a speck of iodine that leaves the thyroid that's not bound up in hormones. It's called non-hormonal iodine, pretty simple name, but there's not much of that. So by and large, unless your thyroid is cranking out a lot of thyroid hormones, it's not moving through much iodine. And consequently, you could have had a high intake for some period of time, and then that stopped. And after then, your intake might be totally appropriate. However, that amount that would be appropriate in other circumstances may be enough to prevent your thyroid from getting rid of all that extra iodine that built up back when. You may not be able to clear out that backlog. And that's why I advocate a low iodine diet, not because iodine is bad, but because it gives a toxic thyroid a chance to get rid of that excess. You go below the day's needs so the extra amounts that have built up can leave the thyroid and allow it to heal itself and repair. So what happens if there's a ton of iodine? Well, many people have been taking supplements that have literally hundreds of times the amount that's safe on a given daily basis. I'll tell you what I mean. We think that the upper limit of someone prone to thyroid disease is somewhere around 200 micrograms of iodine. That's like 0.2 milligrams. There's a lot of popular supplements that have 50 milligrams, 50 milligrams. So that's literally 250 times that safe day's upper limit in a single flipping pill. There's also a lot of liquid products that are 50 milligrams or 5,000 micrograms, 50,000 micrograms per individual drop. So yeah, one single drop can have 50,000 micrograms, and people are taking many drops per day. And we'll see amounts this high in a lot of seaweed products as well. So yeah, you can ingest years worth of iodine in the course of several days. And your body does work hard to get rid of the extra, but when there's a whole lot stuck in your thyroid, it only comes out so fast. So we see in populations, when they're exposed to changing amounts of iodine, it might take 3 to 6 months for them to reach a new steady state. It can take quite a while. And we know this is true for individuals as well. Those who have been exposed to very high amounts, it could take 3, 6, 12 months to clear the excess once they get to a low enough range. Now, some people take longer to get down to a safe low intake of iodine than others. It's only when you get to that low level that the clock starts to tick. So this is a case to where one of the few cases to where urinary iodine testing can have some utility. Let's say that you took some iodine pills, your thyroid was goofed up for a while afterward. Now you've been doing a low iodine diet, but it doesn't seem to be getting better. And you might be wondering, you know, maybe it won't help. Maybe it's too late. Maybe my thyroid is damaged. Or maybe there's still iodine coming out. Maybe it's not had a chance to heal itself. How do you tell that difference? Well, testing can help. So if you've been on a low iodine diet for at least 3 months and you've not seen improvement to your thyroid levels, a urinary iodine creatinine test can be useful. Now, this is a test you can take randomly at any time of day. It's not the same as urinary iodine. It's similar, but it's different. So it's urinary iodine to creatinine ratio. And the results are shown up as UIC, urinary iodine to creatinine. So what's happening is the amount of iodine you excrete in your urine can fluctuate a lot. And how active your kidneys are at a given moment can determine how much iodine shows up. By measuring creatinine and by making a ratio of iodine to creatinine, you can take out some of that randomness. Now, this won't tell you your body's status of iodine. It won't say whether you need more or less if you're deficient. It doesn't work that way. But it can tell you how you're eliminating iodine. They're different concepts. They relate, but they're different. So if you're in that situation, you've been at it for 3 months working really hard, and you do this test, and your urinary iodine to creatinine ratio comes back at, say, 38, which is on the lower side. What that means is it's now low. And the possible interpretations are maybe you just now got low enough like yesterday. In that case, you'd want to watch for these coming months for benefits. Now, if you did that 3 months ago and you were low and you tested 3 months later and you were still low, then you can know that you've been in that state for several months and the benefits should start to be showing up. On the other hand, if you were on a low iodine diet and you tested and you were at 130, where you're still up in the range, you're not in that desirable low range yet. In that case, it's possible that one of two things, either there's some iodine coming into your system that you've not accounted for just yet. That's one possibility. Think about your shampoo. Think about your conditioner, your body lotion. Look at the condiments or seasonings you're using. Double check the vitamins. If they've got iodine listed, it's too much. So that's one possibility. The other one is you just need more time. Maybe you were someone to where you were exposed to a whopping dose for quite a while, and it's just not out of your body yet. And, you know, only you can tell on that. So just troubleshoot, think through, see if there are some hidden sources, and try that much harder. Oftentimes what I'll hear someone say is that, well, I did most of it, but I still had my milk, or I still had my whatever. I didn't think this one thing was that much of a big deal. So just figure it's a big deal. Your thyroid's a big deal. Your health is a big deal. So take it seriously. Try it hard. Do your best. Once you've done that, recheck again several months out. But once you see that your excretion of urine iodine is low enough, that's when your thyroid can start to heal. And so then it may be 3 to 6 months after that point. But yeah, this is a time to where testing can be helpful. Now, a couple of things you can think about. General hydration. The bulk of iodine that does leaves through your kidneys. You pee it out. So the better hydrated you are, the easier that happens. There's some iodine that also leaves through the bile and through the stool. So you want to be pooping regularly too. So a good intake of a good variety of fibers, healthy regular bowels, those are important. And then last up, we think about some of the micronutrients that help your body regulate circulating iodine. Those include selenium, zinc, and iron. Selenium and zinc are ones that are safe to ingest on a regular basis. I include those in the thyroid daily and the daily reset bundle. You get those in there. Iron is one to where if you need it, you should know, you should take it, and you should quit. You want to be targeted and specific about your approach with it. But if those things are lacking, your body cannot regulate iodine quite as well. So how much do you want in a given day? Well, if you're maintaining general health, you don't have any thyroid problems, or your thyroid function is stable, you want between 50 and 100 micrograms. If you're pregnant or breastfeeding, that's more like 150 to 250. Now, if you're on thyroid medication, you can think about this being about 50 micrograms lower. And if you're trying to help your thyroid work better, then we're thinking about less than 100 micrograms, so a lower amount. What does that look like in terms of diet? You know, the thyroid reset diet, I broke down foods into green light, yellow light, and red light. Green light, most fruits, veggies, legumes, nuts and seeds, most animal proteins, most egg whites, they fall in there. These are things that there's more to your diet than iodine for sure, but as far as iodine goes, you can eat freely from all those food categories. Then we think about the yellow light foods. These may have some, a moderate amount, but probably not high amounts. And you can add these in if your thyroid is stable, or if you're pregnant, they can have some utility. The red ones are really high in iodine, and that's going to be sea veggies, most dairy foods, highly processed grains, iodine supplements, iodine in cosmetics. And these are things you do want to avoid to help maintain good thyroid function. And then finally, how should I take iodine, night or in the morning? Well, for most people, you're not taking iodine. There's some that's in the diet that's normal. The time of day it's consumed doesn't really have a bearing on this outcome. It doesn't make it better or worse sometimes versus others. So yeah, not a consideration that way. The foods that have those moderate amounts, if they're appropriate, they can be had whatever time of day. When you're on the green light foods, same thing, the time of day is not a critical difference. All right, Dr. C here with you. And this is about how to quickly reduce iodine levels. You can get it down, and doing so can reverse thyroid disease for most anyone. I'm really excited to share that message. Take good care, and I'll talk to you soon.